Welcome, everyone, back to a brand new show here with Robbie Vice and myself called Virtue Advice Brand of Wrestling. It's not brand new, but we took a week off.
We did.
Hey, what's up, man? What's going on?
Oh, man. Not much. I heard there was something that happened yesterday that people are clamoring about, and I guess there's a reason that SmackDown's probably not going to be very good tonight.
So Crown Jewel was yesterday. On a Thursday in Saudi Arabia on Halloween. Who books Scary. This stuff? Knowing that they have SmackDown on Friday on Fox, could they have pre-taped a show? So you know what I mean?
For $10 billion, I don't think Vince gives a shit. So.
And that's the thing. I mean, right now we know Vince McMahon and WWE have put all of their financial eggs in the one basket that's labeled Fox, USA, and Saudi Arabia.
Right.
Because outside of that, they are hurting. And why, Robbie? Because they don't have a good creative team in place, and they don't let the handcuffs off of the top stars to pull in casuals. Remember back in the day, I mean, we can even say it with John Cena, right? We can say
with
Kurt Angle, Stone Cold, The Rock, Triple H.
DDP, man. You could go back to WCW, DDP, Booker T. Booker T, which we got to give credit to Vince Russo for that, right?
Yeah, I mean, at least the main event run, but he probably would have got it. He probably would have got it anyway, but I'm glad that Vince Russo expedited that Booker T to the top, because I think prior to that, he was a tag team champion multiple times with Stevie Ray, Harlem Heat, and I think he was U.S. champion. But here's let's go to Crown Jewel, okay? So they have talent stuck over there, right? And they're chartering flights, and the planes have issues. I mean, I don't know about you. I wouldn't want to sit there and wait for a plane to get fixed and then fly off in it. I hate that stuff. So like right now, I'm just hoping everybody gets back. You know, everything's good. But beyond that, the actual show. Okay, I did take the time late last night to watch it. And so I'm happy with some of the results, like Brock Lesnar going over. That's their WWE champion. It's one thing to bring in these other athletes like Tyson Fury and Cain Velasquez, however you say his name, okay? But you have to push your stars. Unless these pro athletes are coming in to be full-time WWE wrestlers, I mean, Brock's not even full-time, but
no, Ronda was, though. I think Ronda Rousey did it the right way when she came back.
Exactly, but she was there every week.
Correct. Now,
so I'm happy with the Brock Lesnar going over, because guess what? In real life, Kane beat him. So they had to make Brock look strong here for whatever story they want to tell.
Yeah.
Roman got the win for Team Hogan, got the pin. You know, that. And I guess Roman got pretty good reception over there. Interesting. But out of the blue, they decide to announce this women's match, which makes me feel it was very, very last minute. That maybe Saudi Arabia didn't want this to happen, but maybe Vince McMahon and WWE management worked their charm. So we get Lacey, and it might have been planned ahead of time, because why else would those girls have flown over there? So we got Lacey Evans versus Natty. And I know there was a women's match, a first-time women's match over in the other Emirates States area. I think it was Sasha Banks and Alexa Bliss several years back. You know, they had to wear head to toe, you know, covered up or whatever. So that happened over there. What is the big deal about this match? Now, yes, two women performers performed. Like, this is a stage performance. This is an actual sport with an actual competition, like women's soccer over there. You know what I mean? So
I'm drinking the Kool-Aid on this one. I'm drinking the Kool-Aid on this one, and I'm on the other side of that.
This is blown out of proportion, and I feel the only reason why anybody would say they're on the other side is because they don't want to get treated as a sexist. Now, again, great for them being the first, but my issue's not with them. You know, they hugged it out. Lacey was out of character. I had an issue with that.
Sure.
You know, granted, they had to wear the clothes. But my issue is, why not two other women that actually, like, were top stars, right? That's just weird that they picked two mid-carders.
They might have been the only ones that said yes.
The fake people. My issue is always with the fake people and the fans.
Right.
And I don't care if I get heat for this. You know me.
Yeah.
All of a sudden, it's blood money. I'm not watching. And then all of a sudden, this match gets announced, and they watch and talk about it and cry and yay. I just don't like Benedict Arnold. So please tell me your side of this. Again, I am not sexist. Great.
I don't
for
think you are. You're allowed to have an opinion. I thought the match sucked. Yeah. I thought the match itself was a throwaway match. Obviously, I don't care much for Natalya, and I think it's important because it's at least something positive to take away that we could have women on a TV on a Saudi show. I will give it that much. I don't think it changes the world. I don't think it changes anything for the people who live there. I think you said it best. You know, hey, girls, look at this. In Saudi Arabia, you can grow up to do anything you want as long as you're not born here and you're brought over under the protection of a billionaire who we need to, as a public image crisis fixing thing. So, yes, I think it was a good step. I think it's historic. The match was a throwaway match. I thought they're, you know, the oversized T-shirt thing. I don't know. I get it. I get why they did it. Yeah, there is a lot of fake people, though, man. There's a lot of people out there that are just, man, just patting themselves on the back to the point. I feel like their arms are going to fall off.
Don't forget about Lana. Lana was over there as a valet.
See, I didn't see that. I don't know. Like I said, I don't really follow the pay-per-views, and I'm one of the blood money people. I did look at the recaps and things like that, though, and, you know, there were some good things that happened, but, man, they just... I don't know. Like I said, I think it's a step in the right direction, but until things change within the country itself, you know, maybe stop patting yourself on the back so hard.
Now, my thumbnail was the Fiend, Bray Wyatt, holding up the Universal Championship. Now, I did a small little poll, and of course, you know, I think Aaron Rift was a little too afraid to retweet it off the NoDQ account because it was basically saying what was more memorable, and I had Natty versus Lacey as a choice, Brock squashing Fear, Kane, and then... You know, when the show was over, and then what was the fourth thing? Oh, Bray Wyatt becoming the Universal Championship. And even though it had like 60 votes at the time, guess what was winning? Fiend winning the Universal Championship. So even with this historic moment for the ladies, that was still a pretty big deal that the Fiend wins the Universal Championship.
I was shocked when I saw that. Virtue, I didn't think it was going to happen. You know, I probably went on a rant on one of the reviews talking about it is... Why are they going to drop the belt to someone who's not even on Raw for basically the Raw Championship, the Universal title? I was flat out wrong that they did that. And I watched some YouTube clips. But from a lot of the things I saw, the match was okay. I don't like the red light gimmick. I thought the match probably went too long. And it almost looked like they built him up to be Kane before his match with The Undertaker, where he was literally indestructible. So I don't really know how they book The Fiend at this point. If he's going to hold the belt for a year, I think this is good. If this eventually maybe even leads to Finn Balor getting a faction at NXT, starting an invasion angle, and then they could go head-to-head at some point, good. But my fear is they're going to cool off on this. The fans may be fickle and cool off on this, and I just don't know where they go from here. I have no idea.
Well, they should have won it at Hell in a Cell, right?
Right,
They should limit the no-sell stuff. Like, I get his supernatural powers in the Fiend gimmick with the mask. Undertaker had the urn. So I'd be okay with some no-selling. Sure. But not at the level they did it at Hell in a Cell. And this red light gimmick, if that's his power, the red light gives him the extra no-sell power, I'd be fine if the red light only came on periodically, and then all of a sudden he just no-sold everything, and then maybe somebody could break the red light, and then all of a sudden he's more beatable like Bray Wyatt. But they had to do this because, you know, yes, it's probably too late, but the fact is they at least are trying to save this whole Fiend angle now.
They did.
And they can book themselves out of this. They can figure out a way to strip him of the title, have him do something so heinous that management says you're stripped of the Universal title, right? Easy peasy. They can book themselves out of this if he stays on SmackDown.
Oh, I know how they can get the belt off him. Go ahead. Explain.
Well, like, so this is fat. I'm glad he won it. They crapped on Bray Wyatt during his rise to prominence with the Wyatt family. He finally got the WWE title, and then they jobbed him out to Orton in his stupid gimmicky match. Finally, I'm glad he's come back to this point. Okay,
but now lose the belt and still be strong. And I'm going to tell you how they're going to.
Where do they go?
They're going to make Bray Wyatt defend his title at some point, and he's not going to be the Fiend. And he's going to warn him. He's like, he's not going to like this. He's not going to like this when he finds out, and he's going to lose his belt. And then the Fiend is going to start chasing again. And then maybe that's a way to keep him chasing, keeping him fresh, and that's a way to keep him strong. I don't know. I think the best thing to do is to make Bray Wyatt defend the title instead of the Fiend if they want to drop it. I just hope they don't drop it to some loser like Kofi Kingston or some lowlife like that, because we at least need it to be believable. Because Kofi's right back to the mid-card of just being beat by one finisher and, you know, tossing pancakes and smiling at the crowd. So hopefully they don't try to make a run with that again.
I mean, to me, they drafted, you know, I think when the draft happened, they promoted him as the Fiend. I don't know if it said Bray Wyatt, the Fiend, or was it a picture of the actual guy in the mask?
SmackDown drafted Bray Wyatt.
Okay.
And it showed Bray Wyatt.
So that's interesting, but we saw the Fiend on that initial episode of SmackDown.
Yeah.
Has he been on it since as the Fiend?
I don't think so.
Yeah. So, but that's, they could easily do that for the time being. They could have Bray Wyatt, that part of the gimmick on SmackDown, right? Staying brand loyal, and the Fiend, the split personality, is a Universal Champion on Raw, right? I mean, granted, that's Mick Foley, 97, 98. I get it. But why not? At least you have some time. At least we know you're giving some effort on trying to, you know, for us to understand why would you put the Universal title on this guy after you already put him on SmackDown. Because, again, they painted themselves into a corner. They can't keep burying the gimmick and making him look bad, like the finish of the Hell in a Cell. And somebody's bright mind, Vince McMahon, whoever it was, oh, well, we can end the match by the ref stopping it, which, awful decision because it was a Hell in a Cell. But he can no-sell and get mad after the match. And all of a sudden beat up on Rollins again. Well, why didn't he do that during
the
match?
And make blood burst from his throat, and he's just on Raw the next day. He's fine. Oh, no, they kept him off Raw for a week, didn't they?
Yeah. They should have just had Fiend just win the title that night, and then we wouldn't have had this convolution here.
I like your idea. I like having him just a regular match, and then that red light comes on, and he goes berserk. I wouldn't even mind seeing him have a little bit of a faction stable, maybe a manager. For some reason, and maybe I'm wrong all the time, but I would really love to see him being managed by Broken Matt Hardy, or have Broken Matt Hardy involved or controlling him, or figure something out, just because I think the two of them together could just take this even further, and just, their genius would just overflow. And I may be wrong, but I would like to see something like that.
Well, like, what I want to know is, like, if the Fiend's plane doesn't get here, I guess Brock Lesnar's did, so he should be on SmackDown tonight. Yeah. But, like, if the Fiend's didn't get, why can't he just teleport? I mean, he's the Fiend, right? He should just be able to teleport. Or why couldn't they film something over there, you know, backstage or wherever, a couple things from some of the wrestlers that can't get back, and they could have at least some backstages tonight.
You know what would be sweet? Oh, my God, for Bray Wyatt.
They need good creative.
They did.
See, you and I are shooting ideas back and forth that could save tonight's SmackDown, and they don't have people in place that think of easy concepts like this?
Imagine if they did a pre-tape thing of Bray Wyatt, not the Fiend, backstage at Saudi Arabia, just lost. He doesn't know what's going on. He just wants to get home. He's kind of scared. And then, you know, by the end of the night, the Fiend shows up. You know, just something, because that could build to the aura. It could build to the character. I don't know. Character development, story, you know, these things that are somewhat important to wrestling.
I'm glad he has it. And look, there are people out there that are absolutely loving WWE stock falling under 60 to 55. The fact that the third quarter financials, you know, show, you know, a couple million dollars decrease in revenue. People, I mean, is it sad that people live for this? Now, look, I want anything that I have been a fan of over the years, I want them to succeed. Now, like I said, we know they're putting all their eggs in the basket of Fox, USA, and Saudi Arabia. I hope these numbers, the declining numbers, finally makes them think, well, what did we used to do where we sold house show tickets, where we could sell out Raws and SmackDown?
It's never going to do that again. There's too much wrestling now.
There's
with
too
AEW,
much wrestling, but...
And there's too much. There's fatigue with the fan base.
But you might not be able to get to where a Monday Night Raw filled the upper deck in arenas and full big basketball arenas. But you can maybe head towards that way again if you just get great creative and allow them to let the top stars go out there with no handcuffs. Again, bullet points, if you have a vision of a feud you want. But that's what they did in the Attitude Era. I mean, there was some crazy writing, but the top stars got over on their own because they were allowed to go out there and get over on their own. And it made all-time legends. The Rock, Triple H, Mick Foley thrived off of that. Stone Cold Steve Austin, The Rock became the biggest Hollywood movie star, right? How do you know there's not somebody? John Cena, right? That's kind of where it got cut off.
Here's the thing with that.
John Cena was the cutoff point where pretty much that's the last guy they were going to let.
Superstar.
That was the last guy they were going to let be bigger than the WWE. That whole CM Punk run had something to do with that, I think. But go ahead.
This is gonna make people upset, and apparently that's what it is. And before I say this, I'm gonna say this real quick.
Truth hurts, Rob.
It does. So everyone gives me shit because they say I'm a WWE shill. Because I criticize parts of AEW. I have said each week, probably the last 2 weeks, that I thought the AEW was a much better show than NXT. I have conceded that week after week. I just have some criticisms. With that being said, I think part of the problem with today's product is you talked about guys that were just legends, but they came up the old school way. Yeah. I just feel that a lot of these indie guys, and, you know, not to quote Jim Cornette on everything I do, but they just feel more like make-believe pretend wrestlers and not professional wrestlers.
Perfect.
You know,
absolutely.
Killer Kowalski, what, trained Triple H? He trained China too, right? Like,
where did Chris Jericho train? He was one of the last truly trained in the dungeon.
Correct. And it shows. And then you got guys, you know, and people want to shit on Joey Ryan. If you look at Joey Ryan's earlier work, he's not a bad worker. He's using his gimmick to get money. I kudos to him if that's what he wants to do. It's not something I want to watch, but like,
He made it to Impact.
And then, right. He made it to Impact. He made it to the E show. But then you just got assholes like Orange Cassidy. There's people that have no business being in wrestling as a wrestler manager. Yeah. You got guys like Marco Stunt. Marco Stunt was the guy that you were friends with in high school because you could do any move to him because he weighed 75 pounds. You know what I mean?
Dude, he was the backyard wrestling guy, yeah.
Exactly. We're going to powerbomb. It's like the guy who does the fucking elbow drops on the microwaves. Like, that's Marco Stunt. Why doesn't AEW sign that guy, right? That guy could be coming out.
Dude, he's already been in the indies working matches. I mean.
Has he really?
All right, I'm not going to talk. No more about that guy. Woo-woo. His guardian should be prosecuted to the fullest for endangerment. All right, go ahead. Go ahead. Keep going, man. I didn't mean to cut you off.
No, you're good. But I just don't feel like people are trained in the old way anymore. And you don't. A lot of these veteran guys now, they only either work in the WWE Performance Center. You know, you got guys like Dean Malenko and AEW. But like, dude, man, a lot of these indie guys, they just don't have that guidance of what the business should be. And they just do things to placate and make their friends happy. And wrestling is supposed to be hard. Wrestling isn't something that anyone could just jump into and be a champion. You had to put in time. You had to put in work. You know, there's a good chance you didn't make it. You slept in your car. Mick Foley lived out of his car to follow his dream. People need that level of passion, and they just don't have it anymore.
Dude, do you think Vince McMahon would dress up as any of his wrestlers to do a selfie with him? Do you think Vince McMahon would dress up as The Fiend? Or because Tony Khan dressed up as Orange Cassidy.
He's a mark.
I mean, that tells
he's
you.
A mark.
Yeah, that picture explains everything you just said.
Yeah, he's a mark. Yeah, Vince McMahon, as much as people, is Vince McMahon out of touch? Yes, he's like 9,000 years old. Of course he's out of touch. But Vince McMahon, he understands wrestling. And he may not do the wrestling that everyone likes, but he does the wrestling that the most people like. So I just think more people like him in the industry. He wouldn't have been able to take over every territory if he didn't know what he was doing. He wouldn't win every single wrestling war. He's not going to lose to AEW. NXT might not get the best ratings compared to All Elite Wrestling. But
he's already winning
with his C show. And he is winning.
Because not obviously NXT is not beating AEW in the ratings. But guess what? AEW is under a million people.
Like 795,000 is last week. I know that was the World Series.
That's a win for WWE, in my opinion, so far.
And, you know, AEW, I thought the SCU, we'll talk about that for a second. I thought AEW SCU winning, I thought was a good choice. I actually thought the Lucha Brothers would go over. They got me a little bit. And, man, I think everything Cody Rhodes does so far has just been fantastic. He takes it seriously. I like it. I loved the Tony Schiavone thing with him riding in a limo, talking about Dusty. You know, making the Jericho match feel like a big deal. It made Jericho feel like a legit threat. You know what I mean? Like, and he is, obviously, but it's just him and Jericho are just on this plateau that's so much higher than everybody else in that company. And everyone wants to believe that Orange Cassidy's and Marco Stunt's and even Sammy Guevara, who I think is great. No one's even in the stratosphere of these two guys. Without
Dude, Jericho
them, this company's
pumpkin.
Nothing.
Jericho's pumpkin jacket.
Yeah, I know, right?
And I feel like Jericho, he's not blowing his wad with this. You know what I mean? He's just slowly, methodically, like giving us a little bit something to take home. The cigar. He could do so much more. He can make every second he's on the camera like wow. But he's not. He's doing some stuff, just kind of coasting, just so he can do whatever is supposed to be like memed that night, like the cigar. And I like that approach because he knows there's weeks and weeks ahead of TV. And in a lot of situations, people in that situation would blow their wad, but Chris Jericho is milking it, and that's the veteran that he is. And he's making us watch every week just to see what that little thing he does that gets us to talk. I know you weren't a big fan of his prior week's thing, but guess what
he did? It was still the best thing on the show. It just
exactly.
And, but who did he learn from?
A lot of people, but like...
For a weekly episodic television show... He has learned from, you know, Bischoff, you know, good, bad.
Oh,
Vince Russo, good and bad. Vince McMahon, you know, he has been literally under the best in the history of wrestling television most of his career. And he's a student and he learned and he memorized and he executes every single night.
And look, back in the day when we had WCW versus WWF, ECW was the third little stepchild at that point. Right. But let's talk about the big two. Growing up in high school, I was always like, man, what if, you know, Sting fought The Undertaker? What you would always think the inner, you know, what if this guy's contract ends and he goes over here? Like, I want to think, you know, what if Jericho goes back to WWF one day or Bray Wyatt goes to AEW? I want to see Wyatt and Jericho, like, you know, just stuff. And I know we've probably seen some of these matches before in WWE, but like, that's what I want to think about. But I think there's so many fans out there that they're either one-sided, they're all WWE and hate AEW or vice versa, they don't want to see anything cool like that, where I just want to see wrestlers thrive, make money, and maybe when they're done here, they go over here and vice versa. And it's just like so divided with the fans. It's nuts. And back then,
I want to watch whatever's the best show.
There was a war back then, but you didn't think of it as divided. You just lived it. It just happened to be two companies going against each other, but talent went back and forth. To both.
And we flipped back and forth. I you know, during certain times, like the Kane and Undertaker storyline, man, I was a little bit more glued to Raw when that was on. But if Sting Hogan during that year was on, I was watching that. Four Horsemen, Ric Flair gets his head slammed in the cage by Kurt Hennig, betrayal. I was watching that. You know, there's so much stuff. When the Road Dogg and Billy Gunn joined DX, man, that next week, I was definitely watching Raw. And the fans won. People, and it's younger people, because even we were growing up, it was Sega Nintendo War, right?
Dude, DDP Macho Man.
Great feud
there, exactly. Even though it was shorter than I'd like. I mean, just and that wasn't even the main feud. That was like a mid-card.
Right.
You know?
But everyone today just has to be us versus them. They can't concede anything. You know, I don't know how many people have blocked me now because I've had one or two negative things to say about all Elite Wrestling, even though I've said they have the best main event scene. They have the best tag team scene. They have the best announcers. They have probably the best. I mean, they have the best top card in wrestling right now with Jericho and Cody Rhodes. So, but if I can say I don't like two people in there, and there's people who have told me I shouldn't even be allowed to watch AEW because I don't love everything about it. And these are the people that just guzzle all this shit for WWE during the Attitude Era and didn't say anything.
You're consistent. You like Cody Rhodes. He's with Brandy.
Right.
They're on TV a lot. That was the Triple H Stephanie gimmick. And whether Cody's not doing that unintentionally or intentionally as a rib, it doesn't matter, right? You are consistent with the things you like. Right.
Correct.
And of course, fans. No, but you don't like these other things about AEW. So, yeah, that's all I wanted to talk about. Like, see how we tried to talk about Crown Jewel, but we ended up talking about AEW because, you know, right now, I guess we got to talk about this war. So, but kudos.
Let me ask you this as a final
note. Kudos to the women for that match. Kudos to Bray Wyatt for going over. You know, it is what it is. What do you want to ask?
This is my last question. Fact or fiction, Tony Schiavone is the best wrestling personality / voice in wrestling today.
I'm just thinking if I can think of anybody better, and I'm not one of those Mauro Ranallo shills, so...
I love Mauro. I'm just saying, man, like...
He's kind of like, remember what JR used to be in 98 where he did backside genuine?
Yes.
Tony's that now, so I'm going to agree with you. He's what JR did back then. Announcer, backstage interviewer, that kind of thing. Yes, I agree with you.
And is Excalibur exposed and probably needs to talk less?
Yeah, I mean, it was like the mask gimmick being on commentary is like maybe one or two shows tops to me.
Yeah, I agree.
And then it's over. You know, like that El Virtuoso did that couple of episodes on the No DQ review?
Yeah.
Couple and done, right?
JR and Shivani should just call the show, I think. I don't know. But anyways, that could be definitely another episode. I know we're running a little bit over, and I don't want our Lady Noelle to murder us. So why don't we wrap this up?
Well, do your plug, man.
You guys can follow me on Twitter at NoDQVice. Follow me on Twitter. Interact with me. We have fun. Especially if you check out any of our YouTube videos. I love to interact with people in the comments. Let me know, am I the smartest guy in the room or am I just full of myself? I like either comments. I will never block you. So let's have a debate. Virtue, if they want to see more of us, hear more of me, hear more of you, or hear more of us together, where are the best places for them to do that?
Well, obviously on NoDQ.com on the NoDQ review, which we are going to do another one next week. Once a month or so, you and I do a show for Andre Corbeil over on Wrestling with Wrestling.com.
And that last one was good. Yeah.
So, and I'm going to see if we can do another one with all three of us. So, you know, we got that. And of course, right here on the BigVitoBrand.com with Virtue and Vice Brand of Wrestling. And of course, I'm Virtue. You can follow me on Twitter at NoDQ_Virtue. Go to my Facebook page, NoDQ.com/Virtue. That's all I got for the remarkable Robbie Vice. I am Virtue. See you next time.
Jamming me in the...
I'll stop, Petey! I'll stop, Petey!
I'll take your robot in your name.
Oh, fine! Stop, Petey! Stop it, Petey! Oh, my God!
This show has fallen apart. I've got this. Let's
get together and use those lips. Let's go! She's such a creep.
Yeah. Don't say. Cake's no good. Why are you touching me? You're talking about another woman. You're touching me.
Yeah. And learn just a verbal if you don't take the trouble to make.